Sword of Omens, give me sight beyond sight.
What about $22 million and the Pentagon has a UFO program? It's about there's an entity out there. There's some kind of non-human intelligence that's living with us on this fucking planet. I'm sorry, I'm getting all wound up.
Do you believe in aliens?
I'm absolutely convinced that's all there is to it.
Do you also believe that UFOs have come to Earth?
There has been and is an existing presence, an ET presence. And I spent millions and millions, I probably spent more as an individual than anybody else in the United States has ever spent on this subject.
I have met with very high-level people, people that really, really are in a position to know what's going on, people that have dumped millions and millions and millions of dollars into researching this stuff, people that you probably know about.
Is it risky for you to say, you know, in public that you believe in UFOs and aliens?
I don't care.
You don't worry that some people will say, did you hear that guy? He sounds like he's crazy.
I don't care.
Why not?
It's not going to make a difference. It's not going to change reality of what I know.
Do you imagine that in our space travels we will encounter other forms of intelligent life?
You don't have to go anywhere.
You can find it here.
Yeah.
Where exactly?
It's just like right under people's noses. It's, oh my gosh. Wow.
That have shared stuff with me off the record that were so out there, I just went, you gotta be kidding me. This is really what you think is happening? And is this like speculation or conjecture? It's like, no, this is like research at the highest level. And it's like, I'll give you a hint, and this is about as far as I wanna go with it. And look, I'm not endorsing this, and I'm not saying that I believe it. I'm just saying that the people that I heard it from are people in a position to know. Like, I can't dismiss it because of the source. And he told me in no uncertain terms that they're walking among us.
Well, Don, it began for me in 1963 when I was assigned to the Supreme Headquarters Allied Powers in Europe. I arrived in the summer of 63 and I was assigned to the Operations Division. I was further assigned to what we call SHOC, the War Room, the Supreme Headquarters Operations Center. And at that time, I was given a cosmic top secret clearance, which was and still is the highest level of security access that NATO has. When I was assigned to the war room, I learned that a study had been initiated in 1961, and everybody was talking about it. They were gossiping about it. And the subject was UFOs, and that intrigued me a bit. When that study was concluded in 1964 and it was published, and I was still working in the war room at that time, I had access to this document. I had a chance to read it. And having been exposed to it, I must tell you honestly that my life has never, ever quite been the same. Because I read firsthand reports, verifiable NATO military material that indicated that the UFOs were not only real, that they represented something far beyond anything I had ever imagined before. When the study was concluded in 64, they concluded that there were four different groups apparently coming and visiting us. Out of those four different groups, one group looked exactly like we do, so much so that they could sit beside you in a restaurant or in an airplane or in a theater, and you'd never know. And that particular point bothered the military guys a lot. Point being that some of these people from somewhere could be walking up and down the corridors of SHAPE headquarters, or they could be walking up and down the corridors of the Pentagon. One day at lunch, a lieutenant colonel made the remark, he says, Jesus, do you realize they could even be in the White House? And there was a little forced laughter at that point, I remember, because a lot of us over the years have had some misgivings about the occupants of the White House. But the point I'm making is that the idea that aliens could be here in our midst bothered the military, because if you're not paranoid when you go into the service, you're certainly trained very quickly to be so. It's the nature of the military mind, I think, to be paranoid. But that was only part of the story. The SHAPE conclusions in 64 were that there were four groups that we knew of. They were apparently interplanetary. Some very likely were interstellar. They even concluded that some of them could be intergalactic. When I retired in 1976, many of our military people knew at that point that we were not simply dealing with visitations from people from other planets or star systems. They had concluded by 76 that some of these visitors very well might be multidimensional in their source.
What does it mean to be human? And before you answer that question, I ask that you just take a moment and really think about it. What does it mean to be human? Is it the fact that we're made of flesh and blood? We have a body? Well, that's not really that uncommon. We share that in common with many other living things on this planet. So maybe it's because we can think for ourselves, right? Keeping in mind there's some invertebrates that can do that as well. So again, not that uncommon. So maybe it's because we walk on two legs and we're bipedal, and that's what sets us aside from everybody else and everything else. And, you know, then again, that's a trait that we share with a common ostrich. So I don't think that's what makes us human. No, I think being human is perhaps one of the easiest things that we can feel and understand innately, but yet one of the most difficult things to be able to describe. And perhaps that is the one thing, being human, that sets us aside from every other life form on this planet. But what if for a moment, mankind wasn't singular? Maybe just for a moment, it's mankinds, plural. Are we as a society even prepared to have that conversation? What if the things that make us human most, like emotions, love, empathy, are not necessarily unique traits to humans within the universe? Maybe other things can experience that too, and maybe the definition of being human isn't having two arms, two legs, and looking like this, or having a body, or having hair or no hair. Maybe being human is far more profound than that, and maybe those traits aren't unique to us. And so for the past decade, I spent a good portion of my time pondering that very question, along with some very incredibly talented individuals within the U.S. government. And our reason for pondering this very question was due to our knowledge of some very extraordinary observations and data collected on behalf of the Advanced Aerospace Threat Identification Program, or you probably know it as ATIP. And what we learned during this time was nothing less than remarkable.
60 Minutes, you're on 60 Minutes. I've seen this quote 10,000 times since you delivered it. But the correspondent, Lara Logan, had asked you about, you know, are they here? Or no, I forget what the question was, but, you know, are you worried that people think you're crazy and you say you're not? And then you said something more provocative, that we don't have to look too far for them.
Right.
Do we know who them is, and what did you mean by it?
Well, there's a couple different ways to go at this. So one is from a hardware standpoint. The other one is from the presence standpoint, ET presence. And you know, a lot of people say, well, whether they're, you know, that they can be among the population, whether they're hybrids or they're some other kind of really look alike, you know, kind of thing. But so you can look at it different kinds of ways, and so I know of a really good high quality researcher who has a fantastic academic credentials and background, and he would be predisposed to the latter, saying that, yeah, they could be among us, you know, but he's probably on the more extreme. He's definitely on the more extreme. Others would say, well, we're safe in saying that there's hardware, you know, so that's among us in a hardware kind of context.
And the discarnate entities, call them spirits, whatever it was that was at the ranch, the spirits that you're going to be investigating through VIX, they could be among us too.
Well, if you follow the literature and pay attention to a lot of other kinds of sources, they absolutely are.
The crypto-terrestrial hypothesis basically sort of maintains that we are sharing a planet with a species that's possibly as far in advance of us as we are as from chimpanzees in certain areas of development. Not necessarily everything. We obviously have some things that the alleged crypto-terrestrials, or CTs as I refer to them for brevity, don't have, like a global infrastructure. I think it seems likely to me that the CTs utilize imagery that we associate with extrasolar aliens to disguise their presence, to kind of mask where they're coming from, and to throw us off the scent. I think one thing that this secret civilization among us has going for it is a very prolonged, maintained, and very well-cultivated sense of stealth. I think that they thrive on secrecy. I think that's a big asset. I think they're flesh and blood. I think a lot of them could possibly pass for human. And I think that they share the planet with us, and I think they're nomadic. And it seems to me that they are... here to stay, in the sense that they've been here a long time. If you look at folklore, we find recurring references to them in different disguises. But then again, that seems to be kind of the hallmark of the whole thing. I think that UFOs are their latest disguise, because we automatically associate that with aliens from other planets. And there's nothing inherently unsound about the extraterrestrial hypothesis, and it's not mutually incompatible with the crypto-terrestrial idea. But nevertheless, I think that when we look at the evidence of like hybridization programs like Bud Hopkins and David Jacobs, I don't see what sense that would really make if it's an extrasolar species interacting with us, why they would have any interest in human DNA like they're alleged to have. On the other hand, if we share a common ancestor with these beings, these people, it begins to make sense. And when you look at certain cases that have reproductive overtones, it's very interesting to consider that we're dealing with a genetically impoverished species right here on Earth that is utilizing us for genetic stock. Because it's very likely that if the crypto-terrestrials are indeed real and indeed sharing the planet with us, that they are marginalized and that they have a very compromised population. If that's so, then they might very well need to replenish their genetic stock from time to time. And to do so under the auspices of being aliens from another star system, another planet, would fall right into kind of what we expect. And it would be the perfect smokescreen, I think. I think it would be very effective, and I think it would fool a great many people. And if you look at popular culture, where we tend to be fascinated by accounts of aliens, to the point where the word aliens is synonymous with the extraterrestrial hypothesis. But I don't think the extraterrestrial idea is the final word. I think it's worth considering, but I also think that the idea that we're sharing the planet, as ludicrous as it may sound when you first consider it, has some good circumstantial evidence to back it up and to complement some of the ideas associated with it. So I wouldn't rule it out at all, and I think it's a real intriguing idea, and the more I look into it, the more credible I find it.
I've actually done my little journey on what I think is going on, and it's constantly evolving. But one thing that, I don't know how much we got into this in our book, actually, you have to remind me, human-looking non-humans. And the reason I'm saying this is that when, for many years, like I would push those stories aside psychologically. Like I did not want to consider them, despite the fact that when you go back through all of the UFO occupant sightings that people have had, probably the single largest group that people identify are operators of these craft that look human.
Yeah.
And right behind them are short little grays. in terms of the number of sightings. But these human occupants, so it's easy, we try to forget them because we want to think extraterrestrial, interplanetary, they can't possibly look like us. How is that possible? And that was always my assumption.
Yeah.
You know, exobiologists and astronomers would always say, and I remember this, they would say, well, we can't expect other life forms that from other planets to look anything like us. Why would they have two arms, two legs, two eyes, and all of that? They could look totally different. However, I've been really turning this around in my mind for a while now. And for a number of reasons, I actually think that there are good reasons to argue that there are at least some of these other beings that look like us. Now, it could be that 40,000 years ago, if we were genetically tweaked, which I have come to believe that we were, that's a whole other thing that we have not talked about.
Right, exactly. But
that some of us might have been taken back then and maybe adopted. And there could be a whole human-looking race of essentially alien in culture that might be interacting with us. They could have been raised and adopted by extraterrestrials way back then. We would have nothing in common with them. That's one possibility. Another possibility is maybe there are parallel forms of evolution on other worlds that are Earth-like, that have, you know, they're in the sweet spot of their orbit of their sun. And that, I think I just read there's something like 6 billion Earth-like planets estimated in the Milky Way galaxy right now. That means they're rocky, they're about the size of Earth, they're about the same distance from their, you know, all of that. And maybe evolution of successful creatures does evolve in certain similar ways, plant, animal. Maybe that's the case. Maybe successful predators might be 5-6 feet above the ground with predator bifocal eyes.
Right. Stereoscopic hearing.
Yeah, with all of it. Like that's a test for evolution. With two arms and two hands are really useful. And bipedal, like that could be a thing that is replicated elsewhere. They might not look exactly like us, but they might look enough like us that they would be humanoid. So to me, that doesn't any longer sound crazy. But here's the last thing I'm just going to say here. This is just me putting my own little theory out there. I think that there are a number of other beings that don't look anything like us.
Yeah.
And I think that there are a number of beings that do. And the thing that we want to ask, and I think we did discuss this, is to what extent, A, they live among us.
Yeah.
Right now. And then to what extent human beings are going utterly to freak out after disclosure with that very thought.
You'd have to-